I grew up in love with American culture. Marvel comics, rock and roll, jazz, movies, musicals, and the plays that I read in paperbacks. I loved their energy and the fact that they weren't English. And if in 1958, when I was 15, you'd asked me what were my three wishes, all three would have been to emigrate to America. My love affair with the American theatre began in its golden age. While the British theatre of the 1950s was still tongue-tied by class and censorship, there was real poetry on the American stage. Writers like Arthur Miller and Tennessee Williams, and the heyday of the Broadway musical lent a new vitality to the British theatre. For me, this is what the special relationship came to mean. The story of Broadway's golden age begins here in the natural harbor of Provincetown, the site of the arrival of the first English settlers in North America, the Pilgrim Fathers. Like so many Americans who succeeded them, they had a dream.
In 1916, Provincetown was the summer home to a crowd of writers, painters, and political activists from New York. The Puritan Pilgrim Fathers might have approved of their political idealism, but they would have been horrified by their sexual freedom and by their passion for the theater. The New Yorkers were emigrants themselves, dissenters from the commercial theater. With their help, this remote fishing town became the unlikely birthplace of a new kind of American drama.
In 1916, a young poet and playwright joined the circle of New Yorkers who had made Provincetown their summer home. They encouraged his writing, and within 4 years, his epic, socially conscious drama was the talk of Broadway. His name was Eugene O'Neill. His masterpiece, A Long Day's Journey Into Night, is an American classic. A harrowing account of the disintegration of a family plagued by illness and addiction. It's the saddest play ever written.
What I've got is serious, Mama. Doc Hardy knows for sure
now.
Oh,
that lying old quack. I warned you he'd invent
something. He called in a specialist to examine.
Don't tell me about Dr. Hardy. If you heard what the doctor at the sanatorium who really knows something said about how he treated me, he said it was a wonder I hadn't gone mad. I told him I had once, that time I ran down in my nightdress to throw myself off the dock. You remember that, don't you? And you want
yes,
me to pay attention to what Dr. Hardy says, oh, no.
Listen, Mama. I'm going to tell you whether you want to hear it or not. I've got to go away to a sanatorium.
O'Neill's success on Broadway was an extraordinary achievement. Broadway has always been a marketplace, a show shop crammed with commodities. It's a glamorous reflection of the American dream. O'Neill was the first serious writer to win a place there with his epic social dramas.
So that was the same audience that would next night go to the Follies or fall at the feet of Noel Coward or anybody who would entertain them. And he was trying to stop them in their tracks with these gigantic tragedies. It was madness. He had to be crazy. And yet, he was doing it.
There's a key to my room. I ain't coming back. I'm going to my own folks where I belong. I don't stay where I ain't wanted. Sick and tired of messing around with white men.
What the hell?
I'm just saving you the trouble, white boy. Now you don't have to break it as soon as my back's turned, so no white man will kick about drinking from the same glass. tired of loafing around with a lot of bums. I'm a gambling man. I'm gonna get in a big crap game. Yeah. And I'm gonna win me a big bankroll. And I'm gonna come back here. And after I get my gambling house open for colored men, I'm gonna visit the bums. Yeah. Maybe I throw a $20 bill on the bar and I say, drink it up. And listen while you pat me on the back. And you say, Joe, you sure is white. But I'll say, no. I'm black. And my dough is black man's dough. And you proud to drink with me.
O'Neill was the first writer to put the American working class on stage, the first to create complex black characters, and the first to lay bare the bleak materialism of his century's version of the American dream.
O'Neill's story has the satisfying neatness of an American folktale. Rags to riches, unperformed playwright to Nobel Prize winner. It begins here, among the sand dunes of Provincetown, when a group of artists and writers from Greenwich Village, including O'Neill, rented shacks like that one, where they could work undisturbed by the heat and clatter of New York City.
In the summer of 1916, O'Neill's friends arranged the first public performance of one of his works. It was a one-act play set on a ship at sea about a dying sailor and his grief-torn companions, bound east for Cardiff.
Give me a drink of water, will you, Drisk? My throat's burning up. I know. What's gonna happen? I'm gonna die, that's what. And the sooner, the better.
No, and be damned to you. You're not. We'll not let you.
I was just thinking, it ain't as bad as people think. Dying.
The play was first produced on an old pier like this one, in a converted shed which stank of fish and smoke from a recent fire. During the performance, there was a storm which rocked the pier and drove the sea up through the gaps in the floorboards, wetting the feet of the actors and the audience. The play was a huge success, and a new age of American theatre was born.
Eugene O'Neill was born, appropriately enough, on Broadway. His father was an actor who spent most of his career touring in a popular production of The Count of Monte Cristo. His mother had been given morphine to alleviate the pain of his birth, and she became an addict. His older brother never forgave him for her subsequent decline into insanity.
I never wanted you to succeed and make me look even worse by comparison. Wanted you to fail. Always jealous of you. Mama's baby! Papa's pet! And it was your being born that started Mama on dope. I know that's not your fault, but all the same, God damn you! I can't help hating your guts!
You have these huge long speeches, you have plays which last 3, 4, 5 hours, endless repetitions. In
but
some of the plays.
The repetitions aren't. Each time there is, it's, you know what it is, as Quintero said, it's a symphony. It's that you have repetitions, but each time it is repeated, it's under different emotional circumstances.
Despite his success, O'Neill never escaped the demons of his childhood. Seasoned in self-destruction, he sank into alcoholism and depression. He was a regular in a dockside New York bar called Jimmy the Priest's, the lowest a drinking man could go. It became the setting for The Iceman Cometh, his play about addiction, fear, and hope.
And then I saw I'd always known that was the only possible way to give her peace and free her from the misery of loving me. And I saw it meant peace for me too, knowing she was at peace. And I felt as if a ton of guilt had been lifted off my mind. I remember I looked down at the bed and suddenly I had to laugh. I couldn't help it. And I knew Evelyn would forgive me. And I remember speaking to her as if it was something I always wanted to say. Well, you know what you can do with your pipe dream now? You damn bitch!
Oh. In O'Neill's plays, gloom spreads over the stage like a sea mist. The audience isn't tickled or teased or stroked. You don't have your fears assuaged or your doubts smoothed. His father said to him once, "What are you trying to do, send them home to commit suicide?" And yet, O'Neill's plays exert a hypnotic power. As the American dream began to falter, O'Neill was hailed as the great playwright of the Depression.
Lord, I'm down, but I'm just another good man down.
As the rich farmlands of the Southwest turned to dust, and poverty swept across the country after the Wall Street crash in 1929, another side of the American dream, a belief that self-betterment meant something more than money and possessions, came to the fore in President Roosevelt's New Deal.
I shall ask the Congress for the one remaining instrument to meet the crisis: broad executive power to wage a war against the emergency as great as the power that would be given to me if we were in fact invaded by a foreign foe.
Mama, that's all right for you. Someday you're gonna wish for Tampa, and Lord, you'll be somewhere down in Tougaloo.
The New Deal brought an unexpected bonus for the theater. In a country which had never subsidized the arts, the Federal Theater Project was set up to create jobs for unemployed theater workers all over America.
We got paid $22 a week, $22.77. That was my salary. And I was only on it for about 5 months.
As what was your job?
I was in a so-called playwriting project, which was a new invention. I was among the first and the last to be on it. And you were supposed to go home and write plays. I think I was the only one of about 40 of them that really wrote anything. But they all had a good time, and they were writing stuff.
The Federal Theater Project launched the careers of writers, actors, and directors. One of its many successes was an all-black production of Macbeth. Its director, Orson Welles.
The scene was changed from Scotland to Haiti, but the spirit of Macbeth and every line in the play has remained intact. In this contribution to the American theater and in other projects under the Works program, we have set our feet on the road toward a brighter future.
Hail King! Behold, where stands the usurper's cursed head? The time is free! All hail Malcolm!
Peace! The charms wound up!
Left-wing theater groups mushroomed all across America during the Depression. The most influential was the Group Theater, founded by a group of actors who worked together for most of the 1930s. The group staged the premieres of 22 new plays. Many of them were written by one of their own actors, Clifford Odets, who was the most celebrated and lavishly praised playwright of the decade. Odette's first produced work transferred quickly to Broadway, here at the Belasco Theatre. It was a one-act agitprop play in which a taxi union holds a meeting to decide whether to go on strike. Waiting for Lefty.
This is your life and mine. It's skull and bones every inch of the road. We're dying by inches for what? For the debutantes to have their sweet coming out parties at the Ritz. Papa's got a daughter. She's got to get her pictures in the papers. Christ, they're making it with our blood. It's slow death or fight. It's war. What are we waiting for? Don't wait for Lefty. He may never come.
Working class, unite and fight!
Waiting for Lefty didn't ask the audience to analyze. It asked them to feel. Don't wait for Lefty, act on your own. It was American self-help married to radical political action. Some of the actors were planted in the audience. And during the performance, they were addressed from the stage as stormbirds of the working class, workers of the world. And the actors yelled back, strike! 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 Strike!
I get tingling right now because I can remember viscerally the whole audience saying, strike. And that's my belief in life. Strike, get up and strike. And that's how I was brought up, and O'Neill was a little too passive.
Did you know what you were being asked to strike for, or against?
Oh, yes, always for the people. Always. I mean, my generation was brought up that way.
Odette's political commitment was matched by his attraction to the glamour and excitement of Hollywood. In 1936, he met the Oscar-winning actress Louise Rayner, and they were married.
To me, he was like a disciple. There was something incredibly beautiful about him, yes. There was a wonderful alertness. He had large gray eyes, a very strong face, very serious face, and he had a great charisma, and it didn't matter what woman there was, if it was Marlene Dietrich or Claire Booth Luce, who was a great woman in his day, they all went for him.
By 1935, Odette's had four plays on Broadway. The best of these, Awake and Sing, a family melodrama set in the Bronx, led to his being hailed with some justice as the American Chekhov. This footage is the earliest surviving record of his work on film.
One thing you won't forget to your dying day. I was the first guy. I wrote my name on you indelibly.
One thing I won't forget. How you left me crying on the bed like I was two for a cent.
Listen.
Sure. Wait till the family goes to the open-air movie. Brings me perfume, grabs my arms.
You won't forget me.
How you left next week?
So I made a mistake, so what? So what? It's years already. Don't act like the Queen of Romania.
Odette's survival in the harshly commercial arena of Broadway was secured by financial assistance from some unlikely benefactors.
One of them was this crazy man, Billy Rose, who produced big extravaganzas like Dumbo and, you know, elephants, and was married to Gypsy Rose Lee and was an ex-songwriter and a screwball. But he thought Odette's was God. And whatever Odette's wrote, he hardly read it. I'm not sure he could read. And he put whatever money was needed. Those guys, they don't exist anymore.
At the peak of his success on Broadway, Odette's turned his back on the theater and went to Hollywood. But his career faltered, and he ended up writing scripts for formulaic B-movies. He never recaptured his success in the theater.
I find our American world today, I find it lacks innocence. I find it lacks the conviction of innocence. As quickly as we can, we are taught the techniques of selling yourself, of getting across, which necessarily means that innocence goes, and experience perhaps shrivels our souls.
In 1952, Clifford Odets was called to testify before Senator McCarthy's House Un-American Activities Committee. Along with many writers struggling to make a career in Hollywood, he reluctantly cooperated with McCarthy to avoid blacklisting.
It's curious. I've never seen a god demolished as fast as he was. He was really treated as a god. And then just scorned. He went to Hollywood, he informed, and he sold himself. I think he informed because he thought he was finished, and he hated himself.
While serious politically committed drama was depicting the underside of the American dream, another kind of theater was extolling its virtues of optimism and self-reliance. The Broadway musical. The musical became a genuine people's theater in a way that Clifford Odets could only dream of. It emerged from the influences which had converged on Broadway in the early years of the century. The Yiddish-speaking Jews from Eastern Europe brought a theatrical tradition called the Shund, a concoction of song, dance, and spectacle.
Hey, what are you laughing at?
I'm laughing at the race.
What race?
The human race.
The human race?
Uh-huh.
What are you laughing at? You don't belong to it.
It was said of the Jewish immigrants to New York that they ate their bread buttered with theater. Show business was one of the few ways of emerging from the ghetto, and they became talented practitioners and eager audiences.
Why is he prospering even
Israel? The intellectual history of my country is inextricably connected to a Jewish population. There's no question about it. We had a dozen theaters in the Lower East Side, Yiddish theaters, and we had a culture of Yiddish writers and actors that fed the mainstream of Broadway theater.
From America itself came vaudeville, burlesque, and the minstrel show, which had its roots in the music and dance traditions of the slave plantations. One of the greatest influences was a dance called the cakewalk.
Well, the cakewalk was created by the slaves to mock the manners and the behavior of the masters, so that therefore, when the masters would have the slaves perform having no idea that they were being mocked. And so that therefore there was this incredibly subversive energy to it.
Take your partner for the cakewalk.
Swing round and show your clothes, my lady.
Appropriated by white performers, the cakewalk became a nationwide sensation. The syncopated music laid the trail for the conquest of popular music by ragtime and jazz.
The various musical shows, operettas, musical comedies, burlesque, revues, the minstrel shows, and the Jewish shunt were tributaries on the wide, deep, and muddy river of Broadway. And on that river, in 1927, arrived the first example of what we now describe as the Broadway musical. Showboat.
Showboat was created by Jerome Kern and Oscar Hammerstein. It was the first true Broadway score in which music, character, and plot were welded together. It told the story of a family of showboat performers in the segregated South.
The curtain rose not on a line of showgirls kicking their legs, but on black dockhands lifting bales of cotton and singing about the hardship of their lives. Here was a musical that was about suffering, poverty, racism, sex between blacks and whites, love that ends unhappily, and of course, about show business.
It was very, very courageous. They told the story of miscegenation, of a black girl passing in the South, married to a white man, discovered, and her life destroyed. All of that was very unusual for musical form in those days.
There's an old man called Mississippi. That's the old man that I want to be. What does he care if the world's got troubled? What does he care if the land ain't free?
Nor Hammerstein took immediate advantage of their breakthrough. It was 16 years later, in 1943, before Hammerstein collaborated with Richard Rodgers to produce the second watershed in the evolution of the Broadway musical, Oklahoma.
All the cattle are standing like statues. All the cattle are standing like statues. They don't turn their heads as they see me ride by, but a little brown maverick is winking her eye. Oh, what a beautiful morning. Oh, what a beautiful day. I got a beautiful
What made Oklahoma remarkable was that it refused to deal with Broadway in its own currency. No gags, no girls, no chance. That was the word in New York during its out-of-town tryout here in New Haven. It wasn't about show business or society people. It wasn't formulaic. It didn't manipulate the audience's feelings. It was about ordinary people and unhappiness and loneliness. And, of course, falling in love.
Like all musicals, it was a collaboration, music almost invariably following words. And from an early stage, the collaboration included the choreographer, Agnes DeMille.
Forward and back. Strut. Over the log. Forward and back.
DeMille's ballet dream sequence at the end of the first act changed the Broadway musical as comprehensively as Rodgers and Hammerstein's music and lyrics.
The best thing about it to me was what Agnes DeMille did. Why doesn't Laurie want this guy who was perfect? Why doesn't she want to go to the picnic with him? Because she's deeply sexual and ashamed of it, and she's drawn to Judd. That was in Agnes's ballet, and that was something I had never seen in a musical, and I liked it for that.
West Side Story also drew on the world of dance. Classical ballet, classical music, and Shakespeare were combined in a miraculous synthesis.
It was a time when juvenile delinquency had taken hold in this country. It was called just that. The headlines were all about Chicano gangs against so-called American. So we said we could do it about that. All the techniques in West Side Story had been used before. What hadn't been used was the content. That was the beginning of saying you can treat anything in a musical.
From Oklahoma in 1943 to West Side Story in 1959, the Broadway musical sat in perfect equilibrium with the appetite of the audience, the talent of the performers, and the taste of the time. Guys and Dolls, Gypsy, Carousel, they're all examples of dramatic art in a singular state of grace.
American musicals show decent, staunch, humble folk progressing with hope in their hearts towards fulfillment of the American dream. They're utterly romantic, full of energy, devoid of cynicism, and doggedly optimistic. Only an American could have ended Carousel, a story of wife beating and death, with the unofficial American national anthem, "You'll Never Walk Alone."
The tension between the optimism and economic freedom of the American dream and the threat of failure and destitution is the thread that runs all through the work of Arthur Miller.
I think the Americans in general live on the edge of a cliff, that fundamentally they're waiting for the other shoe to drop. I don't care who they are. I can always detect that little tingle of who's behind me, and when did I get pushed off the cliff? It's there always. And it's part of the vitality of the country, maybe, that they're always working against this disaster that's about to happen.
Today it's all cut and dried, you know what I mean? There's no chance of bringing friendship to bear or personality. They don't know me anymore.
That's just the point, Willie.
If I had $40 a week, that's all I need.
Kid, I can't take blood from a stone.
How about the year Al Smith was nominated? Your father.
Kid, I've got to see some people.
I'm talking about your father. There were promises made in this office. You mustn't tell me you've got people to see. I put 34 years into this firm. Now I can't pay my insurance. You can't eat the orange and throw away the peel. A man isn't a piece of fruit!
Tell me what happened on the first night, the first performance.
Well, it was simply unbelievable. The play ended, and there was a dead silence. I thought we were sunk. I thought either they didn't get it, excepting I'd heard sobbing in the audience from men. Men were simply burying their faces in handkerchiefs all over the audience. It was like a great funeral, really. It was like being at a funeral. And the reason they didn't applaud, I believe, is that you don't applaud at a funeral. And then when the cyclone hit, it was overwhelming. I was weeping myself at the idea of the power of this damn thing.
Why did you do it? I can't cry, Willie. I search and I search and I search, and I can't understand it. I made the last payment on the house today. Today, dear. And there'll be nobody home. We're free and clear. We're free. We're free. We're free.
Miller's plays are about men struggling to take control over their own lives. His heroes, salesmen, dockers, policemen, farmers, all seek their salvation through asserting their name to redeem their dignity even at the cost of suicide. Willie Loman's dream is that it's possible to reconcile unbridled free enterprise with benign humanity, and it's his tragedy that he doesn't realize that his dream is a fantasy. Death of a Salesman is the parable of 20th century America.
Have you ever been a member of the Communist Party?
Are you a member of the Communist Party? Or have you ever been a member of the
this
Communist Party?
This committee, the
that's
basic principles
the
of Americanism.
That's not the question. The question is, have you ever been a member of the Communist Party?
Do you refuse to answer whether or not you are now have ever been a member of the Communist Party?
Mr. Proctor, when the devil appeared to you, did you see Rebecca Nurse in his company?
No.
Did you see her sister, Mary Eastie, with the devil?
No, I did not.
Did you ever see Giles Corey with the devil? Or his wife, Martha?
I did not see them.
Did you ever see anyone with the devil?
No, I did not.
Mr. Miller, you were charged with contempt because you wouldn't talk about your friends. How do you feel about it now?
I feel the same as I ever did, which is that I don't believe that a man has to become an informer in order to practice his profession freely in the United States.
By that time, let me put it this way, the full force of the Red Scare was diminishing. I knew perfectly well by that time that why they had subpoenaed me, it's because I was engaged to Marilyn Monroe. See, they had been through the writers long since before. They'd never touched me, they'd never reached for me. When I got to Washington, preparing to appear before that committee, my lawyer received a message from the chairman of the committee, saying that if it could be arranged that he would have a photograph taken with Marilyn, he would cancel the whole hearing. I mean, the cynicism of this thing was so total, it was asphyxiating.
My name I cannot sign.
Why? Do you mean to deny this confession when you are free?
I mean to deny nothing.
Then explain to me why you will
because
not...
Because it is my name! Because I cannot have another in my life! because I lie and sign myself to lies! Because I am not worth the dust on the feet of them you have hanged. I have given you my soul. Leave me my name!
Hey, Stella! Hey, Stella!
Arthur Miller is the politically assured poet of the conscience. Tennessee Williams colonized the territory of the personal. He's the forgiving poet of the heart. The South was his garden, planted with overheated romantic relationships, saturated with sex and death, blooming briefly and decaying rapidly. He drew his syntax from the religion he'd acquired in his grandfather's rectories while his father was on the road selling shoes. Paradise, purgatory, and hell.
In 1946, Williams was living on the third floor of that house across the street, working on a play set in Chicago called The Poker Night. Writing late at night, he could hear the streetcars rattling below his window. They came from a district called Cemetery and ended in a rough part of town called Desire. Eventually, of course, he moved the setting from Chicago to New Orleans, and it became his best play, a streetcar named Desire. The power of sexual desire to redeem or destroy is at the heart of A Streetcar Named Desire. Williams' characters, the obsessed, the tormented, the bereft and the forgotten, are looking for lost perfection. But he never judges them or evangelizes for a life less ordinary.
You'll never leave me, baby.
I asked him once, what would he say the theme of Streetcar was? And he said, well, he said, I think it's a plea for the understanding of the delicate people. And Tennessee himself was one of those delicate people.
Would you say you're a happy person, in fact?
Gosh, relatively. I think so. I mean, I don't cultivate gloom in my life. I try not to feel sorry for myself ever.
What is being happy, really? I asked you the question, but I don't know that I could define it.
Does anyone know? Isn't it, I used to think it was, well, I still do think the greatest happiness is felt in moments of great, tenderness between two people.
I loved someone once, and the person I loved, I lost.
Dead.
He was a boy. Just a boy when I was a very young girl. When I was 16, I made the discovery. Love. All at once and much, much too completely. It was like you suddenly turned a blinding light on something that had always been half in shadow. That's how it struck the world for me. But I was unlucky, deluded,
And the first thing that I read, of course, was Streetcar, and I was absolutely floored by it. I think that it's the first time that I understood that it was possible to be an American writer and to write in an American idiom and still write poetry for the stage that really worked.
There was something about the boy, a nervousness, a tenderness, an uncertainty, and I didn't understand. I didn't understand why this boy who wrote poetry didn't seem able to do anything else, lost every job. He came to me for help.
Williams was born in Mississippi. His father was an alcoholic and his mother, a Southern belle who lived on the verge of hysteria. Williams drew on his childhood memories like a spendthrift. The Glass Menagerie, his first performed play, was based on the overwrought atmosphere of his pre-war family life.
Mother, it isn't Tom's fault.
Laura, I don't understand. I don't understand you at all. I've never understood my children. As for you, young man, you're going to make up for what you've done to your sister. Where are you going?
I'm going out.
That's right. Don't let me interfere with your selfish pleasures. Go, go, go to the movies. Go on, then, go!
All right, I will. The more you shout to me about my selfishness, the quicker I'll go. And I won't go to the movie.
I don't care where you go. Walk out just the way your father did. We'll manage without you. I'm strong enough to take care of Laura. You can go to the moon, you selfish dreamer.
Between 1944 and 1957, Williams wrote with a wild energy. The Glass Menagerie, A Streetcar Named Desire, The Rose Tattoo, Summer and Smoke, and Cat on the Hot Tin Roof. Most of these plays look back to a past that has been improved in the memory, to a golden world kissed by wistful idealism. Miller asks the question, how are we to live our lives? And Williams asks, how do we get through the night? Both write with heat and heart. And to the cool and colorless British theater of the time, their work was like a distant and disturbing forest fire. Their passion and commitment was the inspiration that helped to ignite the British stage in the 1950s.
What we took from the American theater, musicals and plays, was energy and a voracious appetite for a sinewy and passionate language used with unembarrassed enthusiasm. For all the commercialism of Broadway, we drew on an ambition to make theatre matter that seemed to have drained away from the British stage. The new world gave life to the old.
They say the neon lights are bright on Broadway.
On Broadway.
They say there's always magic in the air.
On Broadway.
Coming next, it's Mark Lawson and Review.
And you ain't had it.